Welcome to the Fueler podcast. And today we are about to discuss some very interesting topics. Some of them might not be current, but I think with the current COVID crisis and financial downturn which is taking place, it's a good time to discuss the actual car brands which actually failed to make it in India. We have decided to discuss this topic mainly because Maruti Suzuki, during lockdown, was able to sell around 4,000 units, which is not bad if you think about it, but other brands have been suffering a lot. So I think Nissan might exit India, and I think Mitsubishi has already exited India. So I would like to go around and ask everyone which was one car brand which they were actually very surprised by them leaving. And there's a lot of car brands to pick from, as you all know. The one I would like to take as an example is General Motors, obviously. Not because like it's General Motors, it's because like they tried so hard. They didn't just like stick with one brand. But I would like to start with Soham here first, if there's any brand you would like to start with.
So I have to tell a brand which I would want back into India, or like what?
No, you just, it can be anything. You would, either you want them back or you think like, oh, maybe they should have succeeded.
Well, Mitsubishi was anyways, it's not even doing well globally, so it doesn't even matter. They've just, you know, like, they're not even thinking about, you know, making cars. I don't think that's even their main source of revenue nowadays. I think so GM could have done really good because the Cruze was a good car. Like, a lot of people have bought the Cruze. It was a good car. It was a good product in general. But I think so, just that the infrastructure that they had laid out in India. And the funny thing is that there still is a GM factory in India. It's right here in Lonavala. Like, on the way to Lonavala, you can see it. And apparently, if you know the right people, you can still buy a GM car in India. Because I've seen a lot of, you know, like 2018, 2019, Chevrolet Trailblazers, like, roaming around in Pune. And, like, where have they come from? So, like, I'm pretty sure, like, if you know the right people, you can still buy a GM car, but like it will be damn shady to buy it, of course. But I think so Chevy could have done really good. But as we all know, even Chevy in the international market is kind of suffering. Nissan is also suffering. So mainly all of the brands which are suffering in India are also suffering globally, I feel. So I don't know, man. I think so. But personally, since I'm an enthusiast, I would have liked to see Mitsubishi succeed, but since they don't even have any products to that cater to the enthusiasts in the international market also, I really don't care. But saying, like, talking about that, Nissan has actually come out with a really good product. The BS6 Nissan Kicks is like turning a lot of head. A lot of people on our videos have commented saying, review the Nissan Kicks BS6. Apparently, it's a really good deal, but the counterpart of it, the Renault Captur, has apparently been discontinued. So it's just a big, big confusion right now. So I really don't know what to say. What about you, Bhavneet? What do you think?
Well, car brands that have failed in India, I don't have much knowledge about them, so I'm not going to speak. But car brands that could succeed in India, well, Citroen's on its way here. So I really think that Citroen has quite a lot of potential in India, and it's going to do really well because they are really good at very versatile cars with small engines, good mileage. That's basic, the best city cars, and that's basically what India loves. So I'm looking forward to Citroën to come because we saw some testers also around. And I think that's really exciting news. But about cars that have failed in India, I have nothing much to say because I don't know many Indian old companies that have gone. I like companies that work. What about you, Hamza?
Talking about, like, honestly, I would have liked if Peugeot worked in India. Because Peugeot, they have very nice hot hatches, like the 304s and like the 401s. They were nice. I would even have liked to see Fiat do nice in India. Fiat has a Abarth. Like, yeah, the Punto they bought here, it's okay, you can call it a hot hatch. It's got 140 horsepower, but it's not really a hot hatch when you look at it because it doesn't sit low. It doesn't have two doors, you know, the things like that. So if Fiat actually cared about India in a way that they bought more models down here to sell, I would even like one brand that I want more cars from is Kia, because the Seltos is doing so well. And even though people say that the Stinger will come down to India, the Stinger is coming, it's a very unlikely chance because I don't think anybody here wants to spend 50 lakhs on a Korean brand. Like, people don't give Volvo a chance in India. Forget Kia. Like, it's just not going to happen.
About that, the problem, I think so, the thing is that a lot of brands cannot enter the Indian market with their international products is because of our import taxes. Like, dude, we have, you know, like those small little Abarth 595, 695s in India. They are there. It's not like they aren't. But those cars are smaller than the Punto and they are almost twice the money of a Punto in India. So like hot hatches and everything. And you can't build a hot hatch in India. You just don't. You can't. If you make a hot hatch in India, you'll get something like the Baleno RS or whatever it was. So a hot hatch has to be a CBU or a CKD unit. It cannot be a locally produced car. So I think in terms of that, like, what do you say? Enthusiast cars are going to be like start coming out of the market now because Fiat is exiting the market. So the Punto is gone. The GT TSI is now a 6-speed torque converter. So that's also gone. The Baleno RS was always shit and it will remain to be shit. So that's also gone. So what else is left? I really don't know.
JTP is also going. Tata JTP is also getting scrapped.
Yeah, Tata JTP. The only real contender maybe I feel is that the i10 Turbo, Neos Turbo, which is still decent, but we haven't
talked about that car for a while.
Yeah, but still, I don't know what the hell is going on because I haven't seen a single car on the road. I haven't seen a single customer car. I've seen one Aura Turbo on the road, but it was also not a customer-owned car. It was someone like, I think so, a magazine had gotten it or something. So I've never seen TDVs of that car. I've never seen a single one in a showroom. So I don't know, man.
I think that goes to show a lot, you know, like the JTP failed so miserably. And people who have driven the JTP tell me, oh, it's mad fun. It's like a really good car for its money and shit. And I say, okay, then why all these people who kept crying about not having a budget hot hatch, why didn't they buy it? Why wasn't the JTP a success? So I think that goes a long way showing people that, you know, it's not just, yeah, the enthusiasts cry a lot, but then at the end of the day, they go across the road and buy a GT TSI because it just makes much more sense. So let's see. I mean, what are your concluding thoughts, Hamad, on this?
So I think there's a big, what all of you said, like there's a very big thing about this is that every car brand which has failed in India has failed to do one thing, and that's like to make cars exactly what India needs. So that's what Chevrolet failed. What Chevrolet used to do was they would never do market research in India and then just get their models from Asia or like from America and then do a few tweaks here so that they don't have to pay too much import on them and just get them locally manufactured, one year in the factory near Lonavala and one near Gujarat. So that's why they failed. And with Fiat, I think it's sad because they never managed to establish a dealer network because the cars were good. The cars weren't the fault. The product wasn't the fault. The dealer network was so shit and it used to take so long to get the parts and get a car repaired. That's what killed Fiat. But yeah,
No, but then you're saying it's killing Fiat, but Jeep apparently...
Killed Fiat.
Yeah. No, like it's basically the downfall of Fiat, according to you, is the dealer network, right? But Jeep isn't going that bad. And Jeep is basically FCA Corporation, right? So
yeah.
Like, they still have, like, I don't know, like, do they still have a chance? What do you think?
Yeah, Jeep, I think, still has a chance. Like, as what I've seen is they've tried a lot to improve from the Fiat brand. Like, that's what the problem with Fiat was. Like, now it was in everybody's minds. Like, right? After something is bad for a while, like, even if they try to improve, you'll be like, oh no, yeah, whatever. I mean, this car is bad because my friend wanted a repair and it took this long. So that was another, like, the FCA Corporation, they tried taking a second shot at India with, like, the Fiat, because it's not like brands haven't come from abroad and not. So, like, I give you the example of GM, right? GM came into India with Opel first, and that was also a failure. And I think they packed up everything in 2004 or 5 and left. But in 2007, Volkswagen came to India with the Jetta and the Passat. Those are the first two cars. And then they got the Touareg and the Beetle. They did pretty well, and they were also German cars with the same quality standard. So, like, you can see something is going wrong with them not able to, like, properly know who the customer is. So that's what happened with Fiat. Also, people really take in India, if your car is in the workshop for too long, it's a loss, right? Because people commute here a lot. You're mainly commuting to work, so it becomes a hassle. That's what was in everybody's mind. So nobody wanted to pick up a Fiat. I think the Linea Multi-T Jet is very comfortable and good car, but that was a problem after sales network.
Yes, Tane professionally races Linea, so we know. But yeah, what's the next topic, Hamal? What are we talking about now?
So the next topic we're going to be talking about is the Carlos Ghosn case, which has become really interesting in the last 4 days. I'll give everybody a small summary. I'm sure all of you are aware of it. But so in 2018, Carlos Ghosn was accused at Nissan of financial misconduct. And it was not at one count. It was like 3-4 things. And the 4 things expanded into other big things. In fact, I wrote an article about it for our magazine. And it was so huge. And this was before the emails leaked of him actually being innocent. So what he kept trying to say was because he was at Nissan for so long, he had joined Nissan in 2000 and he fired a lot of people because Nissan was not doing well then also, surprise, surprise. And so that returned them to profitability because they shut down 2-3 plants in Japan itself and like started developing cars like the Nissan Leaf and stopped developing cars like the Sentra and the GTR. I think the GTR came, there was a big gap between the last Skyline and the R35. So that was also because of him.
Three-year gap, yeah.
Yeah, there's a three-year gap. And Carlos Ghosn was responsible for it, even though he's So before we begin talking about this, it's important to know what sort of person Carlos Ghosn was. He was a person who specializes in coming into bad situations and turning them around. And he's like renowned for this. Like he was at one point the only person who was the CEO of 2 Fortune 500 companies at the same time. Renault and Nissan. So he was like that sort of a person. And he fired a lot of people very casually. And then that didn't go down well in Japanese culture because they generally don't have CEOs from other countries. He was only the second ever non-Japanese person to come to Japan and be a CEO of a Japanese company. So he kept trying to say that and the court dates didn't go on properly and the whole public opinion shifted against him because they already hated him. It's like very important to know that. Like people didn't forget. People who lost the jobs don't forget. And that was his impression. But very interestingly, in 2019, January, just before COVID, and I think, December 2019, he played it very smart. He left his house. He was under house security, home arrest. He left his house in Tokyo, took a train, a bullet train to Kyoto. There, he stepped into a guitar case, flew to Turkey, and then went to Lebanon. And then he started doing press conferences. So it sounds really insane, but this is real. And I think the funniest part is Hollywood has already approached him to make a movie out of this whole fiasco. So I want to know your opinions on that one. Soham, what is your take on the whole Carlos Ghosn scandal?
I think the thing is that the three companies, I think so now even Mitsubishi is a part of that whole
trio, right? Correct.
Yeah. All of the three companies which are there, they're all struggling in general. Yeah. And regardless of what you do, I think so still Nissan is still fine because they're going down the right path because a few weeks ago they had released their 2021 whatever, you know, like
lineup. 400.
Yeah, lineup of cars, and they showed the 400Z. And like, historically speaking, Nissan has always been famous for their sports cars, like the Silvia, the GTR, Skyline, Sentras, whatever it was. So like, I think so, if they don't appeal to like to the enthusiast market, because I think so the people who really buy Nissans are the people who have already owned Nissans and are thinking to upgrade, is what I personally think. So if you see a nice halo car in their, in the lineup, and the GTR has been there for like over a decade now, it's old school now. So they need something which is new and fresh, and they've always, you know, been taking scraps from Renault or Mitsubishi and just making some sort of concoction out of it. So I think so they are going down the right path, but I don't know about Renault. Renault is struggling really hard now because, in fact, they're struggling so badly that even they've cut down funds from their Renault F1 team. And now this is an official statement from the team principal that Renault is now in F1. Renault is not thinking of trying to be world champions for the next few years. They just want to be, you know, like sustaining themselves in the midfield. This is the actual statement from the team principal. So Mitsubishi, though, we've spoken about it's a gone case. I don't know what the hell they're thinking about. So yeah, what do you think? Yeah.
I think Mitsubishi is very happy making speedboat, air conditioner, jets. Now, I think they left cars. Like, that's...
Yeah, I don't think they're coming back. Because they've killed names, dude. Like, Eclipse. The Eclipse was a nice sports car back in the day. Now, they've just made a hideous looking crossover thing out of it. It's called the Eclipse Fev. PHEV or something. Something stupid. So yeah, Bhavneet, what do you think about this whole situation?
Well, Carlos Ghosn, as Hamad pointed out, was a really good businessman. He was a business tycoon and he was really good at what he did. And he was a very aggressive businessman, which does not line up with the culture of Japanese business. Over there, they're really loyal and they like try to retain as many employees as they can, and firing and actually kicking people out and mass firing and all that stuff is not Japanese business culture at all. So I'm pretty sure that would have just... If that was the start of Carlos Ghosn in Japan, he was already destined to suffer pretty much. But when he did what he did, he got results. So I don't... And now, as Hamad mentioned before, Carlos Ghosn was really famous for taking a company in a bad position and putting them in a really good position. He was a business tycoon and he was very good at it. But he was just very aggressive. He was an aggressive businessman. So that did not line up with the business culture of Japan. And that must have, of course, created quite a lot of unrest amongst the Japanese and the companies, or especially, and created a lot of enemies, which the story has twisted a little bit. And now he is deemed innocent and he was being framed. Hamad, please do let us know more about it. Or Hamza, do you know the rest?
Yeah, he is innocent. He was being framed because he was not a Japanese person. This is like discrimination only. And they wanted him to leave because they wanted it to be a all Japan community, whatever you were saying, how they do business. So it was like, it was all internal planning to kick him out, to fame him, everything. It's really things like this, what movies are made on. It's like, this could be a nice Fast and Furious movie if you think about it, with an actual plot. But
how Fast and Furious?
What, Carlos Ghosn at night will be drag racing, in the morning he's CEO of three major companies.
Yeah, no, but the extraction process of it can be a good Fast and Furious movie.
Yeah. So it's like, oh, there are three turbo spoon Civics going that way, and then they take the crate in which he is in and shit like that. So that's good. But the thing is,
there has to be Renaults. There have to be Renaults, not Civics.
Yeah.
It'll be
Clio. Speaks again.
I like Clios, bro. Clios are so underrated. Yeah. But what I was saying was, yeah, this whole situation has put to light how much politics goes on even in the JDM business side of things. Like, because everybody wants to pretend like all JDM companies don't do anything wrong. Only VW does Dieselgate. Only Chevy does transmission failures. Every company has this side to them. And it's nice to see failures even from Japan, even though that hurts me. But we have to take it. But yeah, about Carlos Ghosn, I hope he gets, justice. But honestly, like, this is something I want to get into. Like, if he was so smart and, you know, he knew how to flip companies and make money, like, before he started getting in there and, you know, asking people to go home, didn't he, like, consult somebody who was familiar with, like, Jap culture that, yo, can I fire 3,000 people today and nobody's going to hate me? Because in America, that might work.
No, so this is where it gets really interesting. Carlos Ghosn had an engineering degree from a French college, and then he went to do his MBA. During his group projects, he was so brutal. His own classmates were like, God, bro, I hope you never go into management. Like, you'll screw everything up. And during his first job at Michelin, he went to Brazil and they said, oh, this tire company, this tire manufacturer, this tire plant is not doing well. They're only producing 1,000 tires a day. So, you know, what can we do to boost productivity and get more workers to, like, maybe produce 1,500? He's like, that's simple. You fire half of them and the rest of them, you just make them work double. So they'll all work like that. And he just kept doing that. And Michelin turned a profit. They were so impressed. They named him head of North America in 5 years. And he was running Michelin. And when they told him to come to Renault, he was like, yeah, cool. And that's where he really flourished, you know. So all these companies obviously they've hired firms like McKinsey and all to tell them, oh, do this like this, don't fire these people. He's like, oh, I don't need to listen to any of this. And he would just do what he felt like. So even when... So this was a very complicated part, like why he was actually kicked out. He wanted to get Renault to own an even bigger chunk of Nissan. And that's when the Nissan people really started worrying. Because Nissan only let in Renault because they were doing really badly at that point of time and Renault was doing okay. So they gave them 49%. What Carlos was trying to do was make it around 60, 65. And then Nissan would never be a properly Japanese owned company after that. So that's what led all these people to, like, frame him like that. And it was like proper framing. They had 4-5 charges. And now he's not CEO of any company. So I don't know. Like, he's just chilling in a house. I guess good.
I wonder what he drove.
Oh, he only drove the best, man. Like, he's a Fortune 500 CEO of not one but two companies.
Probably a Chiron. I think he has a Chiron. Had a Chiron.
No. Carlos Ghosn is the kind of guy that would be able to commission a company to make a car for you.
But what's next on the list, Hamad?
Okay, so this is a little touchy subject for most dealerships. Is the BS4 stock which has not sold out at all? So there's 6,400 crores worth of stock which is just lying there. And these people are begging the Indian government, like, we need to get rid of it, bro. Like, some of these dealerships will just straight up close if they can't sell this stock. It's not even funny. Like, there's a dealership in Panipat which is offering 20,000 rupees off on the Activa and 24K off on the Honda, some CD something. And these are some, dude, they're really cutting their profits and they just want to go. And the high court is like, okay, sell 10% of your stock, everybody. So what are they doing with the rest of the stuff? And it's very shady. Like, I think all of us knew about the BS6 coming. But like, I feel very sympathetic to the dealers because already the automotive sector is doing really poorly. So like, some people are like, oh, you should have offered discounts first only. I mean, they also have to eat, bro. Like, what are they going to do? Like, give stuff for free or what from the beginning? So like, oh, you should have offered these discounts before. So this is it's a really bad spot. So I want to know everybody's take on the BS6 update. And the problem becomes like, you can't register these vehicles after the 10 days. There's a 10-day leeway given again. So what about you? What do you think about this?
It's just really sad, dude. Like, we, I don't know, like, the discounts and all is fine, but it's really stupid. It's a really stupid play from the Indian government as well. Like, you cannot, first of all, where the hell is BS5? Where is BS5? Why is it directly BS6? Like, you should have had BS5 in between. Anyways, but yeah, I mean, like, 6,400 crores worth of stock. Like, stopping production is one thing and letting people not sell the BS4 units is another thing. Like, I think so it's perfectly fine for, you know, like, them to sell the remaining BS4 stock. Like, I genuinely don't see a problem in that. Like, stopping production, yeah, that's something you should have done so that more inventory doesn't keep on stockpiling up in the dealer lots. But if you already have stock, like, what the hell are you supposed to do with so much stock then? Like, just throw it off for, like, scrap or something? No. They're brand new vehicles. Because I remember Hamza sending something on the on our group. They're selling FB Mondial for 90,000 rupees. 90,000 rupees for a FB Mondial. And, like, that's like a 4 lakh rupee bike. But the thing is, you cannot register it. So, like, even if you buy BS4 stock, you cannot do anything. You cannot register it. And I just don't see what they're trying to do with it. And I think so the government is just being too aggressive with their application on BS4. So I think so they just need to cool down a little bit, you know, let people sell whatever they have. Because a lot of companies, they've not even given updates to the BS6 models that they have. Lots of cars haven't gotten BS6 updates. I don't think the Civic has gotten an update. Octavia hasn't gotten an update. Lots of cars, like, these are just like a few that are coming on top of my head right now. So I think so they just need to cool down a little bit, let people sell the remaining BS4 stock or at least a good chunk of it so that, you know, they can at least sustain a few dealerships. Because you're right, like, if dealerships anyways start to close down because they cannot sell BS4 stock, I don't know, like, almost all companies will have to start exiting India because of that. So that's a really sad scene. So what do you think about it, Bhavneet? What do you think people should do?
Well, people can't do anything because it's pretty much what the government says. And this is a matter between the government and the companies. And I feel, in my opinion, this is putting too much pressure onto the car industry. And on a very early stage, as you mentioned, Soham, putting so much pressure on them and telling them, stop production, that's cool. Like, stop production, don't make more. But why stop registration? A car unregistered that is new is pretty much valueless. What are you going to do? You can't drive it. You can make it into a race car, but how many people do that? So now what else do you have left to do with all those BS4 Activas without number plates? What do you need to do with those BS4 Civics without number plates? It's a lot of money, and it's a lot of money that went into production. A company can even reconsider recycling all the parts inside and making new BS6 parts. When you think of the numbers, it's just so much money, and it's just like a complete loss. Wherever you look at it, it's just a loss. Kabaddi ko denge. What else can you do?
Yeah.
So 6,400 crores worth of scrap is in India, guys. Whoever's in the scrap industry, join us. Hamza, what is your take on this?
I really don't know how to feel about it. Like, but honestly, it reminds me of the demonetization situation that we went through a couple of years ago, where you couldn't do anything. Like, okay, now here's the bigger problem that I am seeing is that when you own a dealership, you buy stuff. Like, if I own a Honda dealership, I buy maybe 15,000 Activas, right? So I have already paid for them. So the company is not taking a hit. Me as an individual owning a dealership is taking a hit. So India is doing what India does best, screwing its own people. Nobody else is getting affected. So, but honestly, I'm telling you, these people are going to take a loss. People are not going to be able to eat. And I don't know where these vehicles are going to end up, honestly. But there was also this article I read that somebody is working, because what BS6 actually is doing is muting your emissions. So apparently your car needs to be fitted with 2 or 3 bypass of catalytic converters. So I think a company was working on providing aftermarket BS6 kits. So your car becomes BS6. That is a good idea. But I don't know if the Indian government will be like, yeah, this is good, because it's the Indian government. Like, you know, nothing of logic ever takes place here. So I just hope that everybody who's taking a hit still has money to eat. And like, let's see. I want to say this on a blunt note, that even when BS4 came out, vehicles had just completely lost their charm. Like, their shit. They were so muted. There was no response. When we rode the 390 Adventure BS6, it was so shit. It was genuinely, the BS4 KTM 390 had so much grunt, and you know, the throttle had some response. But the BS6 stuff is so bad. Even the BS6 Activa that we rode. So at this point, I'm just saying, fuck it. Stop doing this BS bullshit and like upgrade the infrastructure to electric stuff, because it doesn't matter. This petrol thing doesn't matter anymore. Like, it's just going to shit. When will they stop? BS10, BS12. And this thing that Soham pointed out about no BS5 being there, that reminds me how every fucking, you know, how like Samsung did S10 to S20. There's no S12, 13, 14, some shit like that is happening. But yeah, I just hope everything. Yeah, go on, Bhavni.
There is a little ray of hope for ICEs. There is ignition entry technology. I don't know what's it called. Soham knows more about it.
No, I don't know what it's called exactly, but apparently it's a new piston and, you know, like firing technology or something like that. I don't know who it was being developed by, but it was being developed by some German company only. So apparently it boosts the efficiency and the fuel economy of a petrol-powered vehicle by almost 40% of what it already is. So that is something that is really upcoming. So it's based something around the spark plugs, the pistons, and like the firing of the car. I'm not exactly sure. So yeah, that's something. And also one more thing, e-turbos are also coming now. Mercedes is partnering with Garrett to produce e-turbos, which are going to be more efficient, more powerful, better for the environment. So that's also coming. So I think, so there is a ray of hope, but still, that is nothing to do with BS6, because of course we are 10 years behind the automotive industry anyways. So all of this is going to come in 2030 for us, so it doesn't even matter.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure, like, in 2030, our kids will be driving e-turbo cars and be like, e-turbo kicked in, bro, or some shit like that. Who the fucking VTEC also exists then?
Our children will love electrics. They'll be like, why does this car make so much noise, Dad? What is this? Why don't I have Apple CarPlay, bro? That door is already there, but...
I
think the funniest thing will be they're like, you pay somebody else to actually put some shit in your car to go. Why don't you just charge it, you losers? Like, what is the scene, bro? You're going to some...
You need to take it to a garage to fix it, bro. Just update it.
I want to talk about one topic, though. And it's really interesting, actually. So, in Pune, if you all know where the main RTO petrol pump is, the main RTO petrol pump is now self-operated. So, there aren't any people working there. Like, you know how people come and, you know, like, put in fuel. Like, those guys who work there. So, basically, they've been fired or something like that. And you basically go... It's basically like American now. You go there, you put it in yourself.
Abroad.
This is because of COVID-19. So, I was discussing it with a few friends the other day. Like, first of all... Everyone knows, bro. Like, even us, we are chindis, bro. Indians are chindis and they'll try to get away with anything they can. So, how does that even work? Like, that's what I want to know because...
I'll tell you.
Yeah, tell me.
Yeah. So, what happens on these pumps is that before you fill in gas, you put in your card, you put in the number, and then when you finish filling up, it bills automatically.
Okay. No, bills automatically, like, what do you mean? Like, I'm confused. Wait.
Okay, see, you reach at the fuel pump, okay? There's a credit card machine there, or a debit card machine, whatever. You swipe. You don't put in an amount, you just swipe.
Okay.
You swipe, and you type in your PIN code. Then you take the thing, and you fill fuel. If you filled for 500... or even 502 rupees, it will cut 502 rupees. That's how it works. So if you take 2,000 rupees fuel, you will have to pay 2,000. It's not like, did you think that you could just fill fuel and then nobody gives a fuck? You take like 25 liters and fuck off or what?
No. That's not what I thought. So I thought ki, see, I'm Hamza. Whatever you're saying, it makes sense. But I am 100% sure that that kind of thing isn't at that petrol pump. I'll tell you right now, that sort of technology isn't at that petrol pump. So, what I thought was, you first put in the amount of fuel that you want. Like, for example, if you want to pay 3,000 bucks of fuel or 4,000 bucks, you put in that, you pay, and then the fuel pump lets you, you know, like, put in that.
Yeah, that's what happened.
But then my friend asked me, like, what if you want to do a full tank? Because, of course, you can't exactly calculate how much that's going to be, right? So, how does that work? And whatever you said, Hamza, it makes sense. Like, swipe the card, you know, like that works. But I personally don't think that sort of thing is there, that fuel pump. Me and Bobby will go and check if it's actually there, something like that.
But yeah. Okay. No. I have a point to raise.
Yes. Go on, Bobby.
Where I come from, Spain, they usually have this. You don't have helpers putting fuel for you. It is prepaid. And if you have a full tank, then it's built on trust. Then you go out, you fill your full tank. And then by the moment you remove it from your car, you remove the plug from your car, the thing will not spray anymore, ever. Anymore at all. So it'll lock in and it'll already be filled. It'll already be ready for a full tank. It has a mechanism, the latch. So you're able to lock it and it'll only unlock after the tank is full. You remove it and then you go pay. But that's still trust. Like people should be decent enough to not fuck off.
Enough.
Yeah. But otherwise, it's a very efficient thing, and it takes less time. Because otherwise,
speaking of this ethical, bro, there was somebody in Delhi, there was a vendor selling mangoes, and he left his cart for 2 minutes and people stole his mangoes, bro.
Oh, dude, off a cart. That's nothing. I remember something that a diesel tanker, like a petrol or diesel tanker, had crashed somewhere. And people were like, the gaon where they crashed, right? There's a village where they crashed. People were coming in with buckets, and like they didn't give a shit about the people who were like hurt or injured from the crash. They got buckets. They started getting fucking diesel from it, dude. And they were fucking off back home. This is the type of shit we have in India, man. Like, if that petrol pump in Pune works on trust, I am going right now and fucking
I'm pretty sure they'll have guards in my polo, and I'm coming back. Jockey has cops everywhere. They have guards.
Yeah, of course. No, like, but still, like, how easy it is to run away, dude. Fill it up, put it back in, fill your cap, put it in sport and fuck off.
No, but see, now this place in Pune, of course, it must have cameras, so it must be recording everything. So, ghar pe aayega chalan fir.
I don't have a front number plate. And what if I remove my back number plate? Then what?
And then anyway, before entering that petrol pump, you will be stopped by a cop.
Yeah, definitely.
Because literally, that's RTO ka chalk.
Okay. So, I'll tell you why.
What if it's a different petrol pump? And the thing is, fine, my number plates are gone. You're saying facial recognition. We're wearing masks nowadays in COVID-19. Then what?
Bro, just go steal fuel and come back, man.
Okay. I'll tell you something very important here. Like, I think so. First of all, these servers we have at the gas station. It's a very it's not there in every country. It only comes to countries where petrol is actually taxed really highly. And the government, so I don't know how many of you have caught on with the news of what happened to petroleum after COVID. It dropped below $0. And there's so much petrol which is stuck in the sea. These people are just chilling in the oil tankers. And they're like, yeah, cool. When COVID goes, we'll start the ship again. And like Russia, Saudi Arabia, they're all losing money like anything. But in India, petrol is a very big source of income for the government. Like, they don't take it lightly. It's 80 rupees right now, right?
Yeah. So, the petrol prices drop at all.
Yeah, in India it didn't, but everywhere else it did. So, according to the government, around 38 rupees is what they earn on each liter we fill. 38 rupees, and the rest of it goes, of course, they have their own costs, right? They have to store it, send it, whatever. So 38 rupees is what they earn. So what Soham was saying, like, you can just take it off. I'll tell you who it's not possible to steal from in this country. The government, bro. You can steal from anybody, but you can't steal from them. They'll steal from you, but you can't steal from them, bro. Like, that's what I was saying. Like, they won't take it so lightly. Like, Soham goes without number plates. First thing they'll be like, bro, where are you going?
I have been roaming around without number plate for over 2 weeks now. No one gives a shit. Trust me.
That day we got stopped by a cop, and the cop asked about his number plate.
When? Yogi, watered gaya na? When did the cop ask me about my number plate?
At PAN card.
No, they didn't ask me about my number plate at all. They didn't even give it to me.
That's what I'm saying, that you got stopped by a cop and you didn't get asked.
By the cops, dude. He didn't even care. He's just like, why the hell are you here? That's it.
Yeah.
Yeah, but I agree. This number plate thing, right? Even registration for that matter. You remember my first death trap, the Pulsar 150? It didn't have number plate. Nobody fucking stopped me. It didn't have brakes, that's another thing, but it didn't have a number plate also.
Okay, so we're going to discuss our final... Okay, so we're going to discuss our final topic today. And this is about the videos the YouTube team has shot during this week. And I'll start with the most exciting one, which Soham did. It's the 700
BHP Accord. So Soham, what were your thoughts on it? I mean, I know you didn't get to drive it, but still.
First of all, the owner is so sweet, man. Like, and he's absolutely crazy. He, like, the road that that was leading up to his house, right? It's still under construction. So he was saying, oh, like if the road was there, we would have taken it out. It does burnouts in fourth gear and all. I'm like, oh, you're crazy. Keep the car inside and it's raining. And it's on drag slicks, so you're going to crash into someone. Yeah, but like, it's absolutely crazy, man, how the tuner scene in India is evolving. Like a few years ago, like if you would have said like what the tuner scene in India was, it was just a few cars, especially in Pune, man. Like you could barely see cars in Pune 2 years ago or something. And now like we've gotten the first M8, BMW M8 in India is in Pune. The only 458 Speciale Aperta is in Pune. A lot of exclusive cars are in Pune now. So yeah, man, I have 700 BHP Accord. First of all, it makes such a loud noise, and we started up in his garage. Yeah, it was deafening. Like for 5 minutes, I couldn't hear myself think. And yeah, it was built in Bangalore by Race Concepts. Insane job. And the guy who owns it, Sagar Dangad, like he went all out, man. He's like, he had his priorities straight. I want a race car and I want it fucking fast. That was it. And he still hasn't completed the build. He still has the LSD to go. But the gearbox is still stock. And he himself is trying to learn on how to launch it and everything. So yeah, I mean, it's something that you don't see usually in India because people are still hesitant on, you know, like modifying the car to such an extreme level. And the fact that he did it, he has some balls, man. Like, it's absolutely crazy.
That is some real underdog stuff, bro. That Accord. That is some real underdog. That will smoke supercars, bro. And once he gets it right, and if he's thinking of putting NOS in that car, he'll smoke anything. I'm telling you.
No, we were after the shoot, we were speaking to him. Yeah. After the shoot, we were speaking to him for like 15-20 minutes, you know, like how the car has to drive. He's like, the car is meant to go in a straight line. If you take it on a corner, you're going to die. You are going to die. He told me straight up. He said that even during launch, and since it doesn't have an LSD, right, the wheel which gets traction, right, it steers to that way. So if the right wheel is getting traction, it's going to steer to the right. If the left wheel is getting traction, it'll steer to the left. So he's saying, like, it is absolutely violent to drive, according to him. And, like,
He says that he has to brace his butt, his arms, his elbows, just to keep it in a straight line. He literally, when he was explaining to us, he said, I need to keep my back completely straight and lock my arms like this and just let this much play. Otherwise, I am going off.
It's absolutely crazy, man. And, like, there are still a lot of components that the car doesn't have. So he told me, I think so, he did the best time he could do unofficially at Valley Run was 12.3, which is okay for like that kind of car. But he's still saying that he doesn't have the proper tires because the tires were secondhand. They were from a city. They were from Joel's city. So that wasn't there. LSD wasn't there. The gearbox wasn't there. He himself didn't have practice because the car was delivered 2 days before the event. And like he basically never drove it apart from the Valley Run. So yeah,
that's a under 10 second car, bro. After it's completely done, it's definitely under 10 second car.
For sure. No, he told me in optimum conditions, in optimum parts and everything, he said sub 10 seconds, easy.
Definitely. I think what the best part about this is, this sort of content is very much exclusive to Drivers Hub, you know. Like, I don't mean to brag or anything, but like, I've seen the channel grow and I don't see anybody else actually focusing on the culture. And by culture, I don't mean like clicking a photo of a Lamborghini or driving. Because people do that in India. Like, there are dedicated pages on Instagram which just wait around and take pictures of cars. Good on them. I mean, that's what they want to do. But like, here you're really this enthusiast culture, I'm sure like,
I hope this video reaches more people. People will be shocked to know that this exists in India. I'm very sure like most people in India don't know this exists here, like this sort of a car. So I think it's really good in that sense. And the next thing I want to get on to is the video which I really enjoyed after a while. It was the Quid and the Alto video. I really want to know like what inspired you to be like, okay, you're going to take these two cars. And it was almost like a Top Gear-esque challenge. Like it reminded me when James May and Richard Hammond and Jeremy took the Maserati and everything. And then they went in a shopping mall and then they just kept doing crazy stuff. I mean, it was obviously, there was some drama to what you guys did. But otherwise, like, what was the thought process behind it? And like, how is the video doing? I have not checked the views. Like, I saw the preview which you sent.
I mean, honestly, the thought process behind that video was like a very things that we, like Soham and I used to do back when we weren't such a huge team. It's like, oh, this would be a mad video and let's do it. So when this video was first pitched to Soham, he just wrote it off. He's like, no, I don't want to do this video. Why should I do this video? And then like, I had to personally message him like, bro, just do this video. And he went and had fun because he's becoming like too commercial. He forgot what.
But that's like, the sad thing. That's the sad thing about Indian YouTube, man. Like that video, I have to say, like, I'm not saying it's the best video in the world. The production isn't as good. Like, it's not the best production we've ever done. But the thing is, like, we're having fun in it. And it's like what enthusiasts should look at, right? We, all of us, I'm pretty sure all of us still watch the old Top Gear clips and everything. And that video is sort of like that. I'm not saying we're trying to copy Top Gear in that sort of sense. But yeah, man, it was a fun video. And it just goes to show, like, you don't have to spend so much money on to buying, you know, like, fun, cheap, like fun cars, basically. Cheap cars, personally, I feel my Alto is more fun than my Polo because I don't give a shit about it. So I just put it in anywhere. I yank the handbrake. I do burnouts in it and I just do stupid shit. So it's more fun. Whereas the Polo, like, I know if I'm going to do something stupid in it, I'm going to blow up the transmission and I have to pay 2 lakhs. So that sort of anxiety is still there when I'm driving the Polo. But whereas the Alto, I know if I do something stupid, if it runs out of coolant, it's still going to run. So yeah, that was the type of things that we were looking at. And we have only a minute left now, less than a minute.
Okay.
Okay, let's conclude then, I guess.
Okay, guys, so we're going to have another podcast soon. And I just wanted to let our viewers know, because the last podcast I saw it had more than 300 views, which is pretty good, actually, like in such a quick time for us, for our podcast. I want to know, all the viewers know, like, you can drop in any questions in the comments and we would love to discuss those on the podcast as well. Because like that's what truly podcasts are about. This is a long format medium and most people don't like it. Like a lot of people, when we put out these videos, they're like, can you make it 30 minutes? But then it wouldn't be a podcast, right? Like this is something. So that's why I would like to advertise the fact that these are available on Stitcher, they're available on Spotify. And soon I hope we can get the clearance for the Google podcast. So you can just be like listening to them. You don't even have to watch our faces or anything because honestly, all the content is in what we're speaking here. So yeah, that's all I want to plug this before we end our podcast.
Cool.
All right.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
All right. Bye, guys.